spiritually and are saved. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. God bless you.
Oh, God. And VIP experience, early bird tickets are £60 or the standard will be painted after the 3rd of December as well. So I've got a flight at the front as well, so that should be a really good event. We will enjoy the event now, so please let us know if you want to go. It would be great for the Compass Party. It should be a great evening now, time of worship in the Lord through his powerful ministry. Amen. Thank you very much.
Amen. And we've got a few birthdays today. Can't see people. Sister Angela Anderson. Sister Georgina. Sister Davina, but she's not here. Might be here later.
No, Sister Angela.
Praise the Lord, everyone. We're going to be reading from Luke chapter 20. Luke chapter 20, verses 1 to 24. One day, as he was teaching the people in the temple courts and preaching the gospel, the chief priests and the teachers of the law, together with the elders, came to him. "Tell us, by what authority are you doing these things?" they said. "Who gave you this authority?" He replied, "I will also ask you a question. Tell me, John's baptism, was it from heaven or from men?" They discussed it among themselves and said, "If we say from heaven, he will ask, why did you believe him? But if we say from men, all the people will stone us because they are pursuing that John was a prophet." So they answered, "We don't know where it's from." Then Jesus said, "Neither will I tell you by what authority I'm doing these things." He went on to tell the people this parable. A man planted a vineyard and rented it to some farmers and went away for a long time. At harvest time, he sent a servant to the tenants so they will give him some of the fruits of the vineyard. But the tenants beat him and sent him away empty-handed. He sent another servant, but that one also they beat and treated shamefully and sent him away empty-handed. He sent still a third, and they wounded him and threw him out. This is the NIV version. Then the owner of the vineyard said, "What shall I do? I will send my son, whom I love. Perhaps they will respect him." And when the tenants saw him, they talked the matter over. This is their year, they said. Let's kill you, and the inheritance will be ours. So they threw him out of the vineyard and killed him. What then will the owner of the vineyard do to them? He will come and kill those. Tenants and give them. Sorry, this glass is And they talked the matter over. This is the year they said, let's kill him and inheritance will be ours. So they threw him out of the vineyard and killed him. What then will the owner of the vineyard do to them? And they came and kill those tenants and give him the vineyard to others. When the people heard this, they said, may this never be. Jesus looked directly at them and asked, what then is the meaning of which is written? And the stone the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. Everyone who falls on the same stone will be broken into pieces, but he who it falls on will be crushed. The teacher of the law and the chief priests looked for a way to arrest him immediately because they knew that he had spoken his parable against them, but they were afraid of the people. Keeping a close watch on him, they sent spies who pretended to be honest. They hoped to catch Jesus in something he said so that they might hand him over to the power authority of the governor. So the spies questioned him, teacher, we know that you speak and teach what is right, and that you do not show partiality, but teach the way of God in accordance with the truth. Is it right for us to pay taxes to Caesar or not? And he said to them, through their duplicity, and said to them, show me a denarius, and whose portrait and inscription are on it? And they say, Caesar's, and they replied. And he said to them, give to Caesar was due to Caesar, and give to God was due to God.
Thank you, Sister Misha. At this time, we're going to have a short exhortation from Sister Georgina.
Verses 1 to 11, and then verses 18 to 23. I just want to apologize from now, if I start coughing, please forgive me, I've been ill all week, but you know God is good.
Amen.
So Matthew chapter 13, from verses 1 to 11, and then 18 to 23. The same day went Jesus out of the house and sat by the seaside, and great multitudes were gathered together unto him, so that he went into a ship and sat, and the whole multitude stood on the shore. And he spake many things unto them in parables, saying, behold, a sower went forth to sow. And when he sowed, some seeds fell by the wayside, and the fowls came and devoured them up. Some fell upon stony places, where they had not much earth, and forthwith they sprung up, because they had no deepness of earth. And when the sun was up, they were scorched, and because they had no roots, they withered away. And some fell upon thorns, and the thorns sprung up and choked them. But other fell into good ground and brought forth fruit, some 100-fold, some 60-fold, some 30-fold. Who hath ears to hear, let him hear. And the disciples came and said, unto him, why speakest thou unto them in parables? He answered and said unto them, because it is given unto you to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven, but to them it is not given. Verses 18 to 23. Hear ye therefore the parable of the sower. When anyone heareth the word of the kingdom, and understandeth it not, then cometh the wicked one, and catcheth away that which was sown in his heart. This is he which receives seed by the wayside. But he that received the seed into stony places, the same is he that heareth the word, and anon with joy receiveth it. Yet hath he no root in himself, but dureth for a while. For when tribulation or persecution ariseth because of the word, by and by he is offended.
He also that receives seed among the thorns is he that heareth the word, and the care of this world and the deceitfulness of riches choke the word, and he becometh unfruitful. But he that receives seed into the good ground is he that heareth the word and understandeth it, which also beareth forth and bringeth forth some 100-fold, some 60, some 30. Amen. My final verse of scripture is going to be taken from the book of Luke, chapter 12, and verse 34. And it reads, "For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also." I'm going to speak to you very briefly from the title, "Where is your treasure?" Where is your treasure? Now, the first question we have to ask is, what is treasure? Put simply, treasure is anything that is precious to you. It could be a piece of jewelry, something that's been handed down from your family over generations. It could be something as simple as a picture that your child drew for you when they were like 2 years old. Anything that is precious to you is your treasure. Now, in this parable, Jesus speaks to a large group of people, and he tells them the parable, but only gives understanding and insight to his disciples. Now, that tells me that those of us that are in the kingdom of God, we have access to the riches that are in God's word. Not everybody may understand the things that's in his word, but it's given unto us to receive. Amen?
Amen.
Jesus is speaking to, as I said, a large crowd. And as he speaks to them and tells them the parable, he speaks about three different types of seeds that falls into the earth. Now, the person that is throwing out the seeds is the person that is speaking the word of God. That's someone that's speaking the truth that is in Jesus Christ. The seed is the word of God. And I'm going to be speaking from the perspective of the seeds that fall into the hearts of people as they heard Jesus speaking. I'm going to put them into three different groups. I'm going to start off with the first seed. Now, in verse 19 of the book of Mark, chapter 13, we can see that the people that received seed and the fowls came and devoured them up, these are people that didn't have understanding of the word of God. Now, this tells me that it's important for us when we hear the scriptures and we hear the word of God being given unto us, it's important for us to go forth and seek understanding. In order for us to understand the word of God, we need the Holy Spirit. We know that it's only the Spirit of God that gives understanding. The Bible says that the Holy Spirit is the gift that God has given to us through Christ Jesus. He is the one that will teach us all things. So we need the Spirit of God in order to understand his word. Now, unfortunately, these people didn't take time to go to the word of God and to gain understanding from the scriptures. So because of that, the enemy had right to come and take the word away from them. That can happen to so many of us in the house of God, unfortunately. If we don't take time out to seek God, if we don't take time out to read and to ask the Holy Spirit to give us insight into his word, the very thing that is within our heart will be taken away from us. Jesus says in the book of Matthew, chapter 13, let me quickly turn and read the scripture. Matthew 13, verse 12 says, For whoever has, to him shall be given, and he shall have more abundance. But whosoever hath not, from him shall be taken even what he has. So that gives us further understanding that if we don't take the very small things that God gives us and we work on it, the very things that we do have will be taken away from us because the enemy will come in and steal. The Bible says that the enemy comes to steal, to kill, and destroy, and that's what he does when we don't have understanding. Thank you, Jesus. I'm going to move on to the second group of seed. This is from Matthew 13, verses 20 to 22. Now, these are people that are happy when they receive the word of God because the Bible tells us. And it shows that they have a level of understanding. They understood the basic message of the gospel, which is the death, the burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. They understood that Jesus Christ died for their sins, that he was buried to put away their sins, and that Jesus Christ rose again to justify them and make them right before the Father. They had this understanding, and therefore they were able to rejoice. But unfortunately, with these people, they didn't take time, once again, unlike the first group, to really delve into the word of God. Because the Bible says when persecution came, these people fell away. They weren't able to stand. They weren't able to draw from the word of God that is in the recesses of their heart to be able to stand when they were persecuted. If they were in the word of God, they would have heard Jesus say, if they persecuted me, they're going to persecute you. If they hated me, they're going to hate you. They didn't understand that Jesus Christ said, if you lose your life for my sake, that you're going to find it.
Amen.
Where was their treasure? For those of us that are in the kingdom of God, it's so important that we treasure the scriptures. The Bible says, where your treasure is,
that is where your heart will be. The people that were in this group unfortunately didn't treasure the word of God enough for them to be able to seek his face and to gain understanding, that they were able to stand when the enemy came against them. The other set of people that is in the second group are people that had no depth of truth in them. The Bible says that these people were taken away from the cares of this world. The Word of God says that all that is in the world is the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. And because of that, these people were drawn away by their lusts, which was such a shame because I thought they could have done so much better for God. The Bible says that you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Unfortunately, they didn't know that, and they were deceived because of what was in the world. Another thing that they didn't really understand, the word of God says, if you sow to the flesh, you will reap corruption. And unfortunately, because they sowed to the flesh, because they didn't have enough of the word of God in them, they weren't able to stand. And because of that, when the things of the world came upon them, it looked attractive. God, Jesus Christ said that we should live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. If we live by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God, when the things of the world comes and presents itself to us, we're able to say, do you know what? I've got enough. You can only offer me three things. You can only offer me the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. For me, that's not enough. That's not enough for me to go and to leave Jesus and to go into the world. The lust of the S, the lust of the flesh, sorry, the lust of the eyes and the pride of life does not satisfy me enough to leave the house of God and to go to the world. So for that, I'm going to use the word of God as my treasure. I'm going to seek him and I'm going to go for him in Jesus' name. Now I'm going to speak about the third group of seed. And this is from verse 23 in the book of Matthew chapter 13. It says, but he that receives seed into the good ground is he that heareth the word and understands it, which also beareth forth fruit, and bringeth forth fruit, some 100-fold, some 60, and some 30. Now that tells me that not all of us in the kingdom of God are equal. Not all of us are going to bring forth fruit the same as our brother and our sister. That's why we can't look at what our brother and sister may have and covet what they have. You don't know what that person may have to have gone through to get to where they get to. The grace that God gives into each person is individual to them, amen? So these people that were in the street, they took time to read the word of God. And I believe that the word of God is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our pathway. That's how these people were able to stand. I believe that they went through similar things that other people might have been through in the first and second group of seed. I don't think that those things were only subject to those people in the first two groups. I believe that they went through similar things. But what is so interesting is that because these people would have been in the word of God, we know they were in the word because they brought forth fruit.
Amen.
They would have understood the scriptures that says that Jesus Christ is the way, that he is the truth, and that he is the life, and that man, no man can go unto the Father but by him.
Amen.
These are people that were not like the five foolish virgins in the other parable that Jesus speaks to us about, where they ran out of oil, where they ran out of the Holy Spirit, where they ran out of the anointing. They had enough to be able to see themselves free. Amen.
Amen.
They were able to draw from the treasure of their heart, which is the word of God, which is Jesus Christ, who is precious to them. They would have understood when the time came, when persecution came upon them, that they were able to go into the word of God and seek God and ask him for help and ask him for understanding. And I had to do that this week. I've really had a hard week health-wise. It's been difficult. I've been off work for a few days. But you know, I had to seek God and I had to ask God and say, Lord, if I'm going to speak to your people about treasure, I need you to help me and give me understanding of what treasure is. I can't stand here and speak to God's people unless I have an understanding myself. Amen? So when these people were going through times of persecution and times of trials, they would have gone into the word of God, and the Holy Spirit gave me the scripture in the book of Psalm 23, where it says, thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Now I had to ask the Holy Spirit, why are you showing me the scripture? What is it about Psalm 23 that is so important? Why is it important for me to know that in a time of persecution that will come against the house of God, that it's important for me to know that you prepare a table me in the presence of my enemies? You see, the Holy Spirit gave me understanding that when I was thinking about the table, we're not talking about a small table that you have in your house. We're not talking about a small table where maybe four or six people can sit down. We're talking about a table that King David spoke about. King David was a king, therefore his mindset was one of wealth and one that had much. So when King David saw the table that God was speaking about, this wasn't a small table. This would have been a very large table. There would have been many things on this table that would have been the best of the fruit that would have been in the land. lacked. There would have been wine, there would have been oil, there would have been bread. And I had to ask the Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, why are you showing me bread? What is the bread about? And he had to remind me that, remember, Jesus said that I am the bread of life, that I am the living bread, and that it is on my flesh, and you to drink on my blood. When you partake of Jesus and you sit at his table, you see, he makes provision for you. When things are difficult or when things are hard, yes, you might, and of us might be really young, and even the light bearers here, you might be young. But you see, when a child comes, when you go out into the world, remember that God has made a table. He's prepared a table for you where there is bread. And the bread that we're talking about is Jesus Christ, and he is the word. He is the way, he is the truth, and he is the life. The bread that we put on the table would have been something that was edible. You could have eaten of it. You see, Jesus Christ wasn't saying, I want you to physically eat of my flesh. He's speaking about his word. He's speaking about the things that he's written in his word for us to take. So when they would have sat at the table, they would have been persecuted. They would have been heavy. They would have been sad. Their heart would have been weary. But as they would have taken off the bread, they would have taken off the word of God, and they would have eaten it. And it would have said, he that dwelleth in a secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say, the Lord is my rock, my God, and my fortress. In whom will I trust? The sun will not smite me by day, nor the moon by night. He that keepeth Israel will not slumber nor sleep. That's what they would have taken off the word of God, as they would have eaten from his table. The Bible also says that these people were taken away because of the, you know, the lust that was in the world. Unfortunately, these people were deceived. The Bible says that the heart of man is desperately wicked and deceitful above all things. Who can know it? That makes me think, if the Bible says that the heart is desperately wicked and deceitful above all things, that tells me that not even the enemy himself can deceive you the way that your heart can deceive you. You see, in the book of Genesis, it speaks in chapter 3 about Eve, and it says that Eve was tempted of Satan, that Satan came to her as a serpent, and he beguiled her. And he said to her, you know, did God say that you should eat from the tree that's in the midst of the garden? And Eve had the word of God, and she said, yes, God said that we should eat from this tree. But the enemy said, you know, you're not going to die. Even though God says you're going to die, you're not going to die if you eat from the tree. Why don't you just take it? Now, the reason why this is interesting to me is because it's important for us, like I said, to have the word of God in abundance in our heart. It's important for us to treasure the word of God. Because you see, the enemy will always come and he will challenge that which you have. He will challenge the small seed that is in your heart. And you need to have enough of the word of God to be able to come at the enemy. Jesus said, you should live by the word, but by every word that proceeds of the mouth of God. So I see in Genesis chapter 3 that the Bible says that when Eve saw the tree was good for food, when she saw it was pleasant to the eyes, when she saw that it would make her wise, that she took of her hand, she took the fruit and she ate it. Satan didn't make her do that. She didn't have enough of the word of God within her. So for the people that are in this third group, them not them having enough of the word of God, they would have known that it would have said in the book of James, that a man is tempted when he's drawn away of his own lust and enticed. So because of that, they would have been able to draw from the word of God and declare spiritual warfare on the enemy and say, no, Satan, I'm not going to take off these things and participate of my flesh. I'm going to war against it. I'm not going to just war against Satan and the heaven and the powers of darkness, but I'm going to war against my own flesh. Sometimes we have to war against our own self, our own nature, because our heart is desperately wicked and it's deceived of our own things. So the treasure that was in their heart was enough for them to be able to stand. And not just to stand, but they did all to stand. Another thing that these people were able to recognize is that the heart is, one, a battlefield, and two, our heart is a garden. Our heart is a battlefield because the word of God says that we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers, the rulers of the darkness of this world, and spiritual wickedness in high places. Our heart is a battlefield because our heart is desperately wicked. There's nothing in us that wants to honor God. There's nothing in us that wants to please God. We have to have a changed heart, amen? The Bible says that we should be renewed in the spirit of our mind. If our mind is not renewed, we're not able to do the things that God will ask us to do. They understood that their heart is a garden. And I say that because many things we go through in life cause things to be sown in our heart. This parable is speaking about seeds and that a sower went forth to sow. And I present it to you that there are other things that can happen in your life that causes seeds to be sown in your heart. These can be seeds of bitterness. These can be seeds of abuse. These can be seeds of frustration. We all go through things as a child growing up, which helped to shape who we are today as adults. And because of that, these people understood that not only they need to war against Satan, but that there were things in their heart that the word of God needed to take care of. That's why the word of God was precious to them. You see, there's a lot of things that, you know, I tend to see and be at home with Dad. You know, Dad likes the garden. He loves being in the garden. And whenever the weather's good, he'll be out there. And from a young child, I remember Dad will be in the garden. You know, there's a few times that we need to do some weeding. We need to take some things out of the earth. So I see him in the garden, he's on his hands and knees, and he's, you know, moving the earth away, getting the fork and digging it up, and get the spade and dig it up. But every now and again, Dad would have to get up and be like, do you know what, this plant is too deep rooted for me to deal with. So he would go into the kitchen and take an old knife, one that we didn't need to use anymore. And he would bring it out into the garden, and he would take the knife and flick away at the earth, flick away, and dig down as far as he can, get on his hands and knees, grab the plant, and he will pull, and he will tug, and he will pull until he can get all of the root of the plant that he didn't want to be in our garden out. Now that's a natural thing, but that has a spiritual significance. You see, in our heart, there are things that can happen to us when we are young that causes things to grow. And unfortunately, unless we use the word of God to uproot those things, they actually stay in our heart, and they will grow, and they will grow for us. The Bible says that if you have a good tree, it will bring forth good fruit. And if there is a bad tree, it's going to bring forth bad fruit. You can't have good and bad fruit coming from the same tree. It's the same thing with our hearts. Our hearts need to be purified. But the purifying agent, apart from the blood of Jesus, is the word of God. He's made provision for us that we're able to have access to his word and have access to his word freely. Amen? So I just want to just encourage you. I hope that this has blessed you. I hope that you've received something from it. I know that I've learned a lot from it. But when times of persecution comes, for those of us that know that we are called by the name of Jesus Christ, for those of us that know that we are called to bring glory to the name of Jesus, seek his word. Let his word be like treasure to you. Let his word comfort you. In times when persecution arises, don't even worry about it. It might be easy for me to say now, but I'm being serious. Don't even worry about it, because we see when persecution comes, that should be a sign to you that you're beginning to look a little bit more like Jesus. When people begin to hate you, you need to begin to look a little bit more like Jesus. So rather than let it bring you down, use the word of God and encourage yourself. David says that he encouraged himself in God. He took off the word of God and he encouraged himself. Let us encourage ourselves with the scriptures. Even the Bible says, it was King David that said, sorry, that your word have I written in my heart, that I might not sin against you. Let us keep the word of God in our heart. Let us use the word of God to encourage us, and let it be our treasure in Jesus' name.
You're going through, find it in the word of God. Amen. At this time, we're going to take up today's offering. We're going to have a song from Shemariah and Dana as they take up the vision for you, and that everything we receive will be used for the furtherance of his kingdom in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Shemariah and Dana.
Oh, God.
Thank you, Dana. At this time, I'd like Pastor Bo Ogle, who's visiting us, and his wife to come and greet the church. Let's give them a round.
But so good to have her, my sister Owen. But now quite going to change the order of our service. And it really is my great pleasure to welcome all our dear friends and visitors who have come to witness the dedication of Kevin and Safari Harris. So I'd like, if I could be informed, if you may have that Lord Benjamin to come with the children, also the grandparents, and I'll also ask the mother to come along also. So please, if you could. So good to see our good friend Gerald. I'm not seeing him, that seems to be on the left. Gerald, let me know you all. Come on. And I just want to say that Joel, if you take a look at anyone else who wants to take pictures at this stage, you can get up from our students, do what we will, take the team and leave them. But I just want to say it's a great privilege to be able to dedicate children unto the Lord. And this privilege I really don't take. We look at Kevin, we look at Safari. Wow, this is a very strong lady. Now, I want to say this. When we look at children, you can never tell who that child is going to be. And oftentimes, I want to say, if we speak into the life of children from even their conception, you will be amazed the seed that we sow into their lives. And I say that to say this, every single one of us, to some degree, we are the product of words. All of us are the product of words. And the more we speak truth, and the more we speak positively into individuals' lives, the better they will be. Sadly, our culture allows us to say things which are negative, and sadly, many are cursed by words that adults speak into the lives of children. Well, I'm glad he feels very at home in church. Because he's coming to the right place. Amen. But I want to say, it really is a great privilege. Every time we pray for a child, a dedicated child unto the Lord, it's an opportunity to set on course that child's life for glory. Every time you have an opportunity to speak life into a dead situation, you're seeing an opportunity for transformation to take place in that child's life. So, first of all, I will speak to Lloyd and Brenda, and I will just ask them very briefly to agree with me, if they do, that they will enter into an agreement, or in biblical terms, a covenant to raise Kevin and Sophia Harris for the glory of God. Now, as parents or guardians, do you both present Kevin and Sophia before God in solemn dedication? You both consecrate yourselves as parents and guardians to bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord? Do you both promise to instruct Kevin and Sophia in the teachings of our Lord Jesus Christ and in the practice of good Christian living and in the development of a Christ-like character. You both promise to the best of your abilities, to shape the home life that both Kevin and Sophia at the right time would naturally give themselves to the open confession of Christ and into the fellowship of the church. Inasmuch as you both promised before God and this people to dedicate Kevin and Sophia to God, and yourselves to the task of rearing them both for God, I charge you both to address yourselves faithfully to this sacred obligation with wisdom, patience, and devotion, and to this end may the blessings of Almighty God rest upon you both. I'm mindful that we have godparents. And godparents, we often do it out of tradition. But there is also an element of input that we would expect from godparents, where they can help the parents to raise the child and nurture that child for the Lord Jesus Christ. And it's an obligation as godparents that I would have you to take seriously, and indeed I can see that you're all mature, and the level of wisdom and responsibility I trust is with you in order for you to do that. In the book of Mark chapter 10 from verse 33 to 16, the scripture reads, "And they brought young children to him, that he should touch them, and his disciples rebuked those that brought them. But when Jesus saw it, he was much displeased, and he said unto them, Suffer the little children to come unto me, and forbid them not, for of such is the kingdom of God. Verily I say unto you, whosoever shall not receive the kingdom of God as a little child, he shall not enter therein. And he took them up in his arms and put his hands upon them and blessed them." Amen. I would like to ask my good friend, Brother Ogun, a fellow minister of the gospel and a pastor of the church of Nottingham, to come. This wasn't planned, so he's just coming. Okay? He's waiting to hear what I have to say. Pastor, I'd like you to just assist me. Now, I'd like you to bring both of these children together. Bring them closer to me. All right, and Gerald, you can take as many pictures as you want, okay? And I'd like you to unmark them. Sophia, Diamond Harris, and Kevin Gina Harris. Pastor, I'd have you to work with me to lay hands. And you know, you're very courteous here on my team. Kevin would like to be prayed for first, but the rest of the ladies before. Gentlemen, so we want to pray for Sophia, Diamond Harris. Church, could you stand? So those who want to take pictures, you can reposition yourself if you so wish. If you just put on, I know you're busy, Lady Sophia. You've got precious, precious jewels in your hand. Father, I lay hands upon Sophia, Diamond Harris, even according to the word of God. Father, I pray for the Holy Spirit. Father, the favor of God to be upon Sophia Diamond Harris. I dedicate this child to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Father, we ask for your blessing upon her life. Bless her spirit, her soul, her mortal body. Father, bless the work of her hands. Bless her intellect. Let the power of Christ be upon her. Father, I pray that you will keep her from the evil. Keep her from the evil spirit. Keep her from evil people. Father, let the hand of God be upon her. Father, I release the blessings of God that makes rich and addeth no sorrow with it upon Sophia's life. Father, you said in thy word, when you gave Moses instructions, you said, Moses, on this wise shall you bless the children of Israel. And Father, we invoke the same blessing in the word of God upon Sophia. Lord, the Lord bless thee and keep thee, Sophia. The Lord make his face to shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee peace in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. She's an active girl. She need that blessing. Kevin Junior Harris. Father, we lay hands upon Kevin Junior Harris. We pray your blessing upon his spirit, his soul, and his mortal body. Father, bless the work of his hands. Bless his intellect. Let there be a divine protection upon Kevin Junior Harris. Keep him from evil. Keep him from evil spirit. Keep him from evil men. Bless his health. Let no sickness or disease come upon him. In the name of Jesus. Father, we release the blessings of God Almighty, the blessing that maketh rich and addeth no sorrow with it, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. And in like manner, Father, we invoke the blessing that God spoke upon the children of Israel through his servant Moses, saying, Kevin Gina Harris, the Lord bless thee and keep thee. Yeah. The Lord make his face shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee peace in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah to God. Let's clap our hands. Hallelujah. Now I want to pray for the parents. I want all three of you to hold hands. This girl is busy. This girl is busy. He will be a shepherd. Father, in the name that's above every name, Father, we pray for your hand to be upon mother, upon guardians. Father, you know what's best in every situation. By your divine wisdom, you have purposed what you have purposed to take place. So Lord, we pray your blessing upon them. Keep and preserve the life of them. Let the power of Christ be upon them. Give them skill and wisdom to raise these children for the glory of God. Father, let your hand of favor and divine provision be upon them. They will never lack. They will never lack. And let the divine presence of God Almighty be upon them as we give thanks. In Jesus' name. Amen. Now, if possible, I'd like the godparents to hold hands. Somebody control this young lady. She's a blessing. She needs some control. Okay. Father, we are so grateful for these godparents that have chosen to devote themselves to these two children. We pray your blessing upon their lives. Pray that you will keep them and preserve them. Impart your divine favor upon their lives. That in due season, through their efforts, combined efforts, in addition to the parents, that, Lord, these two children will be a blessing. They will be successful in all that they endeavor to do. And we pray for the release of your favor upon these precious godparents, that they, with the parents, will be a source of blessing to these children, spiritually, physically, emotionally, financially, intellectually, in every sense. We give you thanks for their lives. In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I just feel I need to pray another prayer for the children. Could you get them to hold that? Is that possible? Pastor, this is the prayer. At this stage of their lives, the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 1 concerning angels that he has made angels to be ministering spirits unto those who are the heirs of salvation. They're not saved yet, but we don't just dedicate children to God without the hope of them being saved. And in likewise, I'm going to ask God, Pastor and I are going to ask the Lord to release guardian angels to preserve them in all that they do and in everywhere that they will go. Father, let me just hold your hands together. That's in the name of Jesus. Father, we look into their lives and into their destiny. We ask for angels of protection will be upon these children. We preserve them for the glory of God. In the name of Jesus, let the angel of the Most High come up and go before them and preserve them for the glory of God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's clap our hands. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Oh, Lord. Feel free to take a few minutes and we'll take some pictures. And your sister Francis. We've got 5 minutes of liberty. Take some pictures with them. We're going to worship for a little and then we change the order of service. Amen. Church, we will worship us. We'll take a minute.
Jesus loves the little children. All the children.
As you know, as Christians, we live by our faith. The Bible says faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. So in reality, they're children. But I believe in time to come, Kevin and Sophia will be born again, Holy Ghost filled Christians. And because of our faith, we're going to give them a gift. And I hand over that to Sister Michelle.
In the shadows.
And Jesus went out and departed from the temple, and his disciples came to him for to show him the buildings of the temple. And Jesus said unto them, see ye not all these things? Verily I say unto you, there shall not be left here one stone upon another that shall not be thrown down. And as he sat upon the Mount of Olives, the disciples came unto him privately, saying, tell us, when shall these things be? And what shall be the sign of thy coming and of the end of the world? And Jesus answered and said unto them, take heed that no man deceive you, for many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. And ye shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that ye be not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. For nations shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. There shall be famines and pestilences and earthquakes in diverse places. All these are the beginning of sorrows. Then shall they deliver you up to be afflicted and shall kill you. And ye shall be hated of all nations for my name's sake. And then shall many be offended and shall betray one another and shall hate one another. And many false prophets shall rise and shall deceive many. And because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. But he that shall endure unto the end, the same shall be saved. And this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come. Father, we give you thanks and we praise you. Speak to us and speak to your people. Give understanding and clarity for what we need to do at this hour in our lives. In Jesus' name. God bless you. You may be seated. I will speak shortly and I'll finish in time. So I've got 20 minutes. I want to speak very shortly for the trigger for final things. You know, if you have a gun and that gun is loaded, unless you press the trigger, it will not fire. And God has given us a trigger. I wish I had more time to read or preach this message, but I want to be respectful to my guests and we'll finish in time. But there is a trigger. And Jesus, in Matthew 24, gives us an understanding that there's other things to come. But if I could just focus on verse 14. When he gave an understanding, he says, he that endure to the end shall be saved. That means the church will need to go through a period of endurance. Throughout the scripture, he spoke about those that are being deceived. Amen. If a person feels secure and they don't know Jesus, they are deceived. Amen. They are deceived, which means they feel secure. But without Jesus, they are deceived. Because Jesus said in the last days, many shall come and says, Lord, have we not done this in your name and done that in your name? And, you know, in thy name done many mighty works. And here's the deception, in that Jesus said to him, depart from me. I know you not. Now, it wouldn't be so bad if we had more than one opportunity to sort out eternity. If, say, we had several opportunities, then perhaps we could say if we miss up on the first turn, we might get another chance. Yeah. But brethren, every time you hear the trigger, it tells you something's going to happen. Amen. Now, I don't want to go into all the signs because these scriptures we're familiar with, okay? But all these things are happening, and deception is one of the spirit in the last hour. People are comfortable. When God says these signs are going to be evident, people are still comfortable. If they hear of an earthquake, it's just an act of nature. They're comfortable. When war breaks out and there's rumors of war, they are still comfortable. And the spirit of deception has got hold of the world. And then the Bible goes on to say, and the devil that deceiveth the whole world was cast into the lake of... So he's there working his deception. But I'm not going to talk about those negative acts. I don't want to talk about some of the signs. I just want to take verse 14. And it says, and this gospel of the kingdom, this gospel, none other, of the kingdom, shall be preached, and take note now, in all the world, for a witness, unto some nations, no, all nations, and then shall the end come. I submit to you the trigger for final things and the return of our Lord Jesus Christ is the gospel being preached throughout all the world and throughout all nations. Let me quickly turn over to the other scripture and then I'm going to just wrap it up quite quickly for you. In the book of Revelations, chapter 7, we read concerning a multitude. And here we understand now that John was seeing things that should come hereafter. And in the spirit, John beheld a host of visions. And it says here in verse 9, John being in the spirit, and this I beheld, and lo, a great multitude, which no man could number. And take note now, where was the gospel going to be preached? In all nations. So take note, the multitude now came out of all nations and kindreds and people and tongues stood before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed in white robes and palms in their hands. In heaven, we won't need these kind of designer clothes, because God has designed a robe for every single person who obeys the gospel of Jesus Christ. It won't be blue, it won't be red, it won't be your favorite color. It will be the color that reflects the purity and the sins that have been washed and cleansed through the blood of Jesus. And the Bible goes on to say, and by the way, I'm going to be there. When it comes, Brother Ogo, you can look for me. I will look for you. But I don't know about anybody else. I've got to be part of that multitude. And if you came to church today and you weren't aware that there's going to be a multitude in heaven, clothed in white, and these represent those that have been, that have come through great tribulation, then today you will know. If you have no understanding of the gospel or the trigger that God is going to use before final things come, in the next 5 minutes, I'm going to share with you what you need to know. Because when Jesus came to establish the kingdom of God, Mark 1:35 says, Jesus spoke and he says, the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe the gospel. Jesus said, the time is fulfilled. What is it that was fulfilled? The time when God was going to set up the kingdom of God upon the earth. For until then, we read about other kingdoms. We knew of the Babylonian kingdoms. We knew of the kingdom of the Medes and Persia. We knew of the Grecian kingdom. We know of the Roman kingdom or the Roman Empire. But in the midst of the Roman Empire, God told Daniel, I'm going to set up a kingdom in the earth. And this kingdom will grow and fill all the earth. And it was going to shatter every other kingdom.
person, if he's going to set up a kingdom, you need to say to yourself, what kind of kingdom is this? This kingdom is an everlasting kingdom. Now, if you're going to be part of that kingdom, and not just from Jerusalem, if you're going to be part of the kingdom, take note what the kingdom is about. You know, I'm a citizen of the United Kingdom, and so are you. And so long as I'm alive and you're alive, you will remain part of the UK unless you emigrate. Now, when God sets up the kingdom, the favor that God gives us is not a temporary favor. As if to say, you're going to be part of the kingdom for 70 years and 10. No. He says, this kingdom is an everlasting kingdom. And if you want to be part of the kingdom, you will be an everlasting subject of his everlasting kingdom, which means the everlasting life of eternal life that Jesus preached about. When you receive the eternal or everlasting life, you're going to be part of the everlasting kingdom. So when Jesus began to preach, Jesus says that God will set up a kingdom. Then the Bible goes on to say that Jesus spoke, and Jesus says the time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of repent ye, believe the gospel. We're going to come to that in a minute. Jesus, the Bible says in Matthew 9:25, he says he went about all the cities and villages, not some, all, and teaching in their synagogues and preaching the gospel of the kingdom and healing every sickness and every disease among the people. Listen to me, church. When we preach the kingdom of God, I don't have to worry what God is going to do. Because for God to convince men and women, what God does, he starts to heal people. He starts to do miraculous things. When God wanted to bring the children of Israel out of Egypt, they could say it was impossible for them to leave Egypt. They had no armament. They had no tanks. They had no guns. They were never equipped as an army. And the Egyptian army was the most powerful army on the earth. Until God called a man called Moses, empowered Moses with the anointing, gave Moses a staff, gave Moses the ability to speak, even though he didn't want to say anything. Just like some people, they don't want to preach the gospel, but they have the ability to preach because they receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Now, when Moses began and he said to Pharaoh, Pharaoh, I've been sent by God. I want you to let my people go. Now, Pharaoh says, he don't know his God. So when the hand of the Lord came upon Moses and the power of God was manifested, he got to a stage that Pharaoh said, look, go quickly. Take everything you want. Because God struck the firstborn of all family, the firstborn of all animals. And when Pharaoh saw that, this God is an awesome God. Because his life was in God's hand. He lost his firstborn. If he provoked God, everybody in Egypt would die. So Pharaoh got afraid. He says, go quickly. Take anything you want. God says, I'm going to show you my power and my wisdom. God says, I'm going to spoil Egypt. So you went to your master. He said, do you have any gold? He picked up the gold and said, go quickly. Do you have any diamonds and pearls? Take them and come out of here quickly. Now, when Jesus came, he wasn't dealing with Pharaoh. He was dealing with the devil. And when Jesus dealt with the devil, he first of all went in the wilderness and says, it is you that have caused such havoc on the earth. And the Bible says he was tempted for 40 days. And when he finished with Satan in the wilderness, totally overcame him. The Bible says Jesus came out of the wilderness. Angels came and ministered unto him. And then the people now got lifted in Galilee. Galilee of the Gentiles. Isaiah prophesied. And it was fulfilled in Christ. When he said the people that sat in darkness, they saw great light. And to them who sit in the valley of the shadow of death, light is come up, and when the lights come up, the light comes to church, into the synagogue, and into the cities, and everything that the devil put upon humanity, Jesus accursed it. He put cancer, Jesus healed. people blindness. Jesus healed them. He recovered some. Jesus made them whole. What I want to say to you, when the kingdom of God comes, it comes with power to demonstrate the power of the King. The gospel of the kingdom is the good news of the kingdom. And what is this good news? Let me share this with you. If the devil has his way, you're not going to go to church. Because the devil knows how it works. He knows that faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. That if you hear the word of God, faith is going to arise in your heart. And you're going to realize what I just read in Revelation. You should be one of the multitudes, clothed in white. But when you look at your current situation, you say, I don't know. I'm going to be here. But listen to me, church. No sin can enter heaven. No power can overcome the Satan except the power of the blood of Jesus. Revelation 12 says, and they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb, by the word of their testimony, and they loved their lives unto the death. Now this is what God says. He says, choose you today which way you're going to go. You can be part of the multitude in heaven when they shout the Son of God, or you can be part of a multitude that Jesus don't even want to talk about. But there's a multitude that's not in heaven, locked up waiting for the day of judgment. But this is not the day of judgment. This is the day of the Lord, when you can receive grace for the gospel of the kingdom of God. It's up to you.
Yes, some were drug addicts,
some were this, some were that. And the Bible says that such were some of you. And the Bible, but you are washed, you are sanctified, you are justified. So, you might say, well, Pastor, you're getting yourself all worked up. I don't want to hear this. Listen to me. God wants to show everybody how serious he is. Let me just read something from the last one. Speaking of Jesus, Ephesians 1:30. In whom after that he trusted, he believed in him. After that he heard the word of truth. He tells you what the word of truth is. The gospel of your personal salvation. In whom after that he believed, you are sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise, which is the earnest of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession. Listen to this. Let me just give you a breakdown of the last verse, which is the earnest of our inheritance. The Amplified Version says, the Spirit, the Holy Ghost, which you have, is the guarantee, the first installment, the pledge, a foretaste of our inheritance until the redemption of God's own purchased possession, his believers, to the praise of his glory. Now, some of you got the Holy Ghost. You didn't even realize that God gave you the Holy Ghost. He was giving you a foretaste of the power of the kingdom to come. And everyone you see speaking in tongues, going crazy for Jesus, they are manifesting the foretaste of what is to come. So what God does, Jerome, when he saves you, I believe you've got the same thing that I got. God says here, after he lets you believe, you are sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise. Do you know what a seal is? It's the sign of authentic work. A seal, like if your majesty give you a letter, she not just write her majesty, she put a seal on it. Everywhere you take that letter, and they see her majesty's seal, they said, this man has favor with her majesty the queen. But when God put a seal on you, he put the Holy Ghost on you.
I spoke to the person and I said he was petrified. Could you imagine going tonight and BBC has a special broadcast? And this is the broadcast. To all the people of the United Kingdom, I have a message from the Lord. He's coming in the next 30 seconds. Black. Listen, the amount of power among you. Now, if somebody tell you Jesus is coming tonight, I'm looking for him. I said what they said in Revelation. Come, Lord Jesus, come. You know, if something good's gonna happen. I don't have time to be afraid. Because if I'm afraid, it means I'm not prepared. But as soon, oh God. I better start with that. Listen, let me just finish. I don't want anybody at all because we don't have time for this. But if you come in the house of God tonight, you know you're not part of the kingdom. When you know that there's going to be a multitude of all nations because the gospel is preached in all nations, and you want to be part of that multitude, I invite you back next week. Raise your hands, we pray for you, and then we dismiss. Is there anyone? Even one? Even one? Yes, Father. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Father, in the name of Jesus, by the power of the living God, Father, I ask you for the Holy Ghost to minister to your people. Let them understand the truth of the power of things. When the gospel is finished being preached, in all the nations of this world, so that they have the witness. Shall we? Father, we thank you for all your friends that have come to be with us. Pray that your Holy Spirit will continue to minister on time. For those that would like to know more, you can see me afterwards, and you can come back next week. Father, we give you praise. Now may the saving grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and the Father, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, be with you all. God bless you. We teach others, especially our guests. Love each other, you will dismiss.